And so he grew up as this loyal, patriotic American kid, you know, born in California, raised here. He didn't know anything else. And so that was his life up until, you know, through the Depression, and then 1941 hits, and the family is rounded up, they lose everything, and they get taken to this place called Tule Lake, which was the American concentration camp located in California, the tip of California right near the Oregon border. And that's where initially all the people from Sacramento area were sent to that camp. So he gets to camp in 1942, and he's actually, you know, between 42 and 43, he's actually having a pretty good time because he started his own theater group within the camp. And so they would go around from barrack to barrack, and they would do these American plays, which he directed and he acted in. And so he was actually having a great time for that 1 year doing these plays in camp. But then 1943 hits February, and the government issued the infamous loyalty questionnaires, which actually you have a copy of in your program, but I'm going to read it to you right now. So hold on, let me pull up my glasses. And I'll talk to you a little bit about his decision to become known as a no-no boy, which is referenced in the play as well. And so the questions, this was February 43, and my dad was 20 years old at the time. And so there were these two questions that really caused quite a bit of trouble. Number 27, are you willing to serve in the armed forces of the United States on combat duty wherever ordered? Number 28, will you swear unqualified allegiance to the United States of America and faithfully defend the United States from any or all attack by foreign or domestic forces, and forswear any form of allegiance or obedience to the Japanese emperor or any other foreign government, power, or organization? And so those that said yes, yes, and a lot of the young men who said yes, yes, they took this as a challenge. They said, you know, we're going to prove our loyalty to you. And if you talk to any of any interviews from the famous 442nd Japanese American infantry unit, decorated, highly decorated, they'll tell you to a man, we had to prove our loyalty to America. And so my dad's position was, why? I don't have to prove anything to you. And from his book, here's what he wrote. Here was my position. Why was I, an American citizen, thrown in prison without cause, without due process? I had registered for the draft as required of citizens of my age and sex in 1942. Why were they questioning my loyalty now? How could they do that? I was an American, a loyal American. If they restored my status as a rightful citizen, let me go free out of this prison, I would do anything required of me. Why should I answer the questions? I would follow my conscience and refuse to register. So that was his stand. And, you know, so those that, actually 12,000 also said no, no. And they were shipped from the camp that they were in. And they were sent to a segregated camp, so-called disloyal Japanese Americans, known as the Tule Lake Segregation Center. So before it was just the Tule Lake Concentration Camp. And so my dad was already there, and so he was already qualified as a no-no. So he actually didn't have to go anywhere. But those that said no-no from all the other camps around the country, they got shipped to this segregated camp called the Tule Lake Segregation Center. In all, 18,700 were confined at Tule Lake, which became a maximum security prison with 1,000 MPs, army tanks, and extra fence built around the whole camp. Those at Tule Lake became known as the No-No Boys, and were branded by the government and the leaders of the JCL as the no good disloyal troublemakers who were making the good Japanese Americans look bad. For this act of protest, dissent, and resistance, the no-nos were stigmatized and ostracized by our own community, ignored and left out of our history and narrative, and to this day have been marginalized and never recognized for their role they played in defending and protecting not only their rights, their civil rights, but the civil rights of all Americans. So in this context, to have the no-nos recognized and actually have a song written in honor of them, it's not only a first for me to hear, but it's also very deeply touching to hear as a son of a no-no boy. So thank you for gathering. So with that, I just want to start by asking some questions. What was your, Daniel, your inspiration for writing this piece?
My inspiration started about 9 years ago when I was in a couple of classes and I got into some bouts with my teachers because there's only about a paragraph dedicated to Pearl Harbor. And we never really went into the internment camps at all. We went into Pearl Harbor, bad equals everything else was fine. And so when I confronted the teachers as to, well, why don't we talk about the internment camps? Because I know that my grandparents were both at Tule Lake. Why don't we talk about this? And most of my teachers were just like, no, we're not going to talk about it. But one teacher in particular said, well, no, they were put there because they bombed Pearl Harbor. And the lack of reaction from my peers was the scariest moment because there wasn't any like, no, that was wrong. There wasn't any this. There was just like, I guess that's truth. I guess what we're being taught is truth. And a lot of the students came to me afterwards and said, what did happen? What happened to your grandparents? What happened after Pearl Harbor? And I was like, oh, people don't know. There's some stories here. So I went back and I talked with my grandmother, and she never really wanted to talk about it at first, but then I started to believe that I was going to be working on some songs. I wanted to dedicate some material to her. So over time, we started to really, really discover what the Japanese-American experience was like in camps. And she said some things very similar. She had a job, she had lots of friends, you know, food was very important to them. And just this kind of sparkle in her eyes and sort of this hope about her experience was like, okay, that's the show. Regardless of what people are forced into, or regardless of what people are forced to do, they still found music, they still found family. If you go to the Japanese American History Museum, you look at the booklet, and all the people were right out, one of their fondest memories was friendships. And that's human, that's the human story, and that for the past 9 years has built it into what it is now, and every person that's part of the show had their input, has had their experience be a part of it. Even our meeting when we talked about that as well, it's so enlightening because the show doesn't have to be one thing. It can be all of these stories and it can be for everybody because that's what art should be.
So yeah, there's a lot going on in the show. and you know, what was your thinking in including the African American jazz singer musician in the context of Nazi, you know, death camps, tying in with the Japanese American incarceration?
It was very, very similar to the stories that aren't told, stories we don't know. The more I dug into the research of World War II, the more I realized that people of color were in concentration camps overseas. There was a huge jazz boom, especially in Germany and in Europe, not so much in America. So a lot of African American performers would play at the Hot Club in France. They would travel overseas because they were a little bit more welcome for their music there. And I thought how fascinating that somebody has to travel to another country to really, really show their music. And as you saw in Lonely Heart, that there was this infatuation with these performers, and they loved these performers. And once Germany occupied France, there is note of them taking people from the clubs or ransacking those clubs. And so once I learned there were people of color in the concentration camps, I said, this is another thing that nobody A, knows or talks about. This needs to be addressed in some way. Because then it goes, oh, somebody sees this show and says, what else don't I know? And then that starts a dialogue. And that's one of the most important things, is to go, what else am I not being told?